Well, we've had so many lies coming this past week. It's very tiresome, isn't it? I want to talk about something else for now. You know, I saw the most unusual billboard sign that I can ever remember seeing. And it was only a few words, and I hope I got it right. But it was sex offenses, crimes of choice. And I thought, wow, what amazing. They find these, you know, sex offenders have baffled psychologists for a long, long time. Why they do it, why they repeat, you know, everything. And they did all kinds of studies and looking for common denominators. And I think the one they liked the most is that they were abused as children. Well, just about everything contains that. So I disagree very much after my own studies. I really do feel it is a choice. And how it starts and so forth, I'll go into it. Remember that monster in Austria that put his daughter down in a basement for 20 years and had children by her. And the mother insists that she didn't know. I have never believed that. I still don't believe it. I think wives have a pretty good idea that something's going on, whether it's in their own house or he's freelancing. Wives know. And one thing that they do have in common is that the men, the sex offender, cannot have a good relationship with his wife. He may be married, but it's a very tenuous thing. It's like the women have resigned themselves to a strange husband, and they just they don't want to hear about his escapades or anything else, because they want their house, they want their lives. You know, and he's a breadwinner, and they just don't want to deal with it. And so many girls, you know, little girls that grow up to be big girls, it is really hard for them to go and turn in their father, because chances are that the sex offender frequently gains the child's confidence or promise to keep it a secret by threatening to kill their parent, you know, their mother, if you ever tell. You know, so it's not an easy thing for the child to come step forward, and whether it's a little boy or a little girl, girls are the more popular target. But they go and tell their mother, and the mothers just shine them off. You know, oh, you've got an overactive imagination. Shame on you. And so this girl goes through the rest of her life being abandoned by her father, who is just using her as a sex toy. And this can continue for years and years. And she's been abandoned by her mother, who chooses the house over confronting her husband about what is he doing. And you know, so she's parentless. The only time that she feels any affection at all is from her father, and when they're having sex. So you can see how this unfolds, and why young girls who are victims of incest almost always are promiscuous, because that's the only time they feel wanted or human warmth. So they have a, you know, terribly warped sense and zero self-esteem. I knew a young woman, very, very attractive, and she's about in her early 30s. And she spoke freely with me, but her incest went on, and starting early, 8. She wasn't really sure. She just knew it was really young. And her father was a Baptist minister. And every Sunday she had to sit in the front row and listen to him preach about sin and all that. So you can, I just can't imagine how difficult that would be. And she even admitted to still having sex with him from time to time when she would see him. This girl, she had problem with, she just wanted to have sex with anybody that came along because that was the only time that she felt reassured that she had some value, you know. So you can see what damage incest does to a female. And of course, anytime, up until just very recent years, anybody who blew the whistle on and accused somebody of incest or being a sex offender, whether it was, you know, an uncle or, you know, stepfather that's out of work and around the house too much, they always said, oh, how dare, how can you even say the word, you know? How can you suggest that? And even today, people are saying, oh, how can you even suggest that little Kaylee was a product of incest? Easy. Everything points to it. But they still want to throw the guilt back onto the woman or the accuser who is guiltless, totally guiltless. But still, they perform this, they insist on shedding, you know, that the whistleblower is at fault. They always are, aren't they? You know, even when it's industry or whatever, you know, it's always the whistleblower's fault. So anyway, well, how it all starts is this man, if he has a wife, he doesn't bond with her very well. He doesn't, he's just really not interested in taking the garbage out or being a good husband or being a good father. He really isn't. I mean, he thinks he's wonderful, but the truth of the matter is he's narcissistic and conceited. And the wife, you know, she wants him to get a better job. She wants him to get off the couch. And pretty soon he stops wanting to, you know, he's not interested in being an adult. And so his attention turns to children who will not be critical of him. You know, they won't ask him to go and make more money. And they won't tell anybody because chances are they have, you know, threatened some. So that's how it all starts. And sex with children were, you know, nobody knows about it, and there's lots of advantages there. And so that's how it starts. And if he goes around and checks out other children in the neighborhood, once again, he can always use the threat, don't tell your parents, or I'll kill them. They'll be dead. You'll never see them again. So this is how it goes on. They start identifying their sex life with children that won't nag at them. They can be the boss. They can be powerful, you know, in this. And that's the switch. But always, 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 it's a choice. They can stop themselves from doing it. All this other stuff is just alibis and excuses. Oops, going over.